Yes, Mushant, we are on live.
Okay, sir. Good evening, participants. I welcome all of you on our digital platform Shield Connect. And today we have a special eminent speaker, Dr. Tara Devi. Today the topic of webinar she is going to take is UTI in pregnancy. So before I start webinar, let me share a little idea of our digital page, Shield Connect. So this is our page, shieldconnect.in. When you log in, you can see there are different sections in Shield Connect page, like a blog. So when you click on blog, you will see various blog written by the eminent speakers on various different topics, like right now, black fungus is the recent one. Then there are other topics also covered. So you can go through this blog sections. Then there is a webinar section where you can see upcoming webinars, in which you will find all the calendar of all the eminent speaker who are taking the webinars, like today, UTI in Pregnancy by Dr. Tara Devi. So when you click on see more, you will get registered. You have to register, and by clicking on register, you will be able to see on our page the webinar, and it is also streamed on YouTube. Then there is a third section, awareness page, immune booster, where you can find our reintroduced product Rudimin Mu. Then there is another awareness page, PCOS awareness page, where you will find all the videos related to PCOS in various regional language, like Hindi, Malayalam, Telugu. Then we have a special day page where you can find all the special day related pages, when Mother's Day. So you will find all the topics related to mother concerns. So this is our page, and now let me start with the intro of our speaker. So Dr. Tara Devi is a MBBS, MS in DNB and CCG DM, consultant obstetrician and gynecologist and laparoscopic surgeon in Tara Devi Clinic, Motherhood Hospital in Bangalore. So ma'am currently practice at Motherhood Hospital as well as Tara Devi Clinic in Bangalore. Ma'am has done MBBS from MS Ramaya Medical College from Bangalore. Ma'am has done MS in Obstetrics and Gynecology from Jawaharlal Nehru Medical College in Belgaum, DNB degree in Obstetric and Gynecology. Also CCGDM, specialized in gestational diabetes mellitus from Public Health Foundation of India. From New Delhi, ma'am also trained in gyne laparoscopy and heteroscopy at Ramesh Hospital, Bangalore. Ma'am is also a member of PSOG, FOCSI, AGOI, Indian Red Cross Society. Ma'am is also part as a coordinator of high-risk pregnancy workshop at AI COG 2019 in Bangalore. Ma'am has published various papers in national and international journals. Ma'am is also a FOCSI quiz winner in 2017. Ma'am has also presented posters and papers in various states and national conferences. Ma'am has also won Best Attendant Award from Bangalore Society of Obstetrics and Gynecology in 2015. And ma'am has also invited faculty to deliver talks and participate in panel discussions at state and national conferences. So, colleagues and participants, you can post your queries in the comment section so we can have a Q&A session with Dr. Tara Devi. And I am very happy and pledge to welcome Dr. Tara Devi on our platform. Ma'am, I hand over this session to you. I welcome you on our platform.
Thank you very much, Nishant, for the kind introduction. I would like to thank Shield Connect for giving me this opportunity to speak to you all today on urinary tract infection in pregnancy. So can I share my slides?
Yes, ma'am.
Is it visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes,
ma'am. So we all know that urinary tract infection is a very common infection in pregnancy, and it's important for us to diagnose this early and treat it to prevent maternal and perinatal morbidity and mortality. So today I will be can happen if you do not diagnose and treat urinary appropriately. So first, the classification of urinary tract. This depends on whether the lower or the upper urinary tract is infected, and also whether there are symptoms or no symptoms.
Madam, sorry to interrupt. The voice is not audible, madam.
Participant, please wait. There is some technical issue. We will get back to you within 1 to 2 minutes.
Sir, you will, Nishant, you will come. Madam, you got disconnected, madam.
Yes, ma'am.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, we can see you.
Yes, we are able to hear you.
No issue.
Using broadband, no?
Yeah, I'm using broadband. One second. Let me just share my screen. Is my slide visible?
Visible, yes. You can make it full screen.
Yeah. So I was telling that we'll go through the following headings to discuss about UTI in pregnancy. So first is the classification of UTI in pregnancy. This depends on the upper or the lower urinary tract being involved and whether the patient is symptomatic or asymptomatic. So asymptomatic bacteriuria is defined as persistent colonization of the urinary tract by significant numbers of bacteria in women without urinary symptoms. The next type of UTI is acute cystitis. Here the bladder is involved, that is the lower urinary system. This is distinguished from asymptomatic bacteriuria by the presence of symptoms such as dysuria, urgency, frequency, nocturia, hematuria, and suprapubic discomfort in an afebrile woman with no evidence of systemic illness. The third and most serious type is the pyelonephritis. This is defined as a significant bacteriuria in the presence of systemic illness and symptoms such as flank or renal angle pain, pyrexia, rigor, nausea, and vomiting. Now, based on the laboratory findings, asymptomatic UTI is when the count of the organisms is more than 1 lakh colony forming units. Symptomatic UTI is when there are 100 organisms per ml of urine with accompanying pyuria, that is more than 7 WBCs per ml. But this diagnosis should be supported by a positive culture, particularly when the patient comes with big symptoms. Now, what is the incidence of UTI? UTI is the second most common infection following respiratory infections. And in pregnancy, the overall incidence is approximately 8%. The incidence of asymptomatic bacteriuria is around 2 to 5% in pregnancy. The incidence of acute cystitis is around 1.3%, and the incidence of pyelonephritis is 2%, with up to 23% of women experience a recurrence in the same pregnancy as the pregnancy advances. The reason for us to understand this condition is because it's independently associated with preterm delivery, intrauterine growth restriction, preeclampsia, and a significant maternal and perinatal morbidity and mortality. So now let us know about the etiology. The most common cause of UTI is the E. coli, and this infection originates from the fecal flora, colonizing the periurethral area. The other organisms which we see in the culture are the Klebsiella, Proteus, and Enterobacter species. And the other organism which is very pathological is the cytohemolytic streptococci, are also known to cause UTI. So the urea splitting bacteria like Proteus, Klebsiella, and Pseudomonas are seen to cause UTI, and in such patients we usually notice renal calculi. The other atypical infections could be chlamydial infections and candida infections resulting in UTI. We have a natural defense mechanism against UTI. Normally, urine itself is bacteriostatic, so organisms do not survive. But when the urine becomes acidic during UTI, that is the one which results in infection. D-mannose in urinary tract does not allow the bacteria to stick to the uroepithelial wall. And also the other mechanism which we have is the bacteria moving upwards are regularly flushed out by urination. Now let us see what is the pathogenesis of the urinary tract infection. So first is colonization. The pathogen colonizes the periurethral area and then it ascends through the urethra upwards towards the bladder. Then there is uroepithelial penetration. The fimbria allows the bladder epithelial cell attachment and penetration. Following penetration, the bacteria continue to replicate within the epithelium and they may form biofilms. Then there is ascending infection. Once there is sufficient bacterial colonization, they ascend on the ureter towards the kidney. The fimbria may aid in the ascending process. The bacterial toxins may also play a role by inhibiting the peristalsis, especially reducing the flow of urine. When the infection ascends to the kidney, it results in pyelonephritis. The infection of the renal parenchyma causes an inflammatory response. And while the infection of the renal parenchyma is usually the result of bacterial ascension, it can also occur from hematogenous spread. If the inflammatory cascade continues, this can result in tubular obstruction and there can be renal damage leading to interstitial edema, causing acute kidney injury. Now, what are the reasons for urinary tract infection being common in women? It is 14 times more frequent than in men because of anatomical causes like a short urethra. And the lower one-third of the urethra is continually contaminated with pathogens from the vagina and the rectum. Also, women tend not to empty their bladders as completely as men do. And the urogenital system is exposed to bacteria during intercourse. There are also other reasons for increased UTI during pregnancy, like the significant physiological changes which occur in the urogenital tract in pregnancy. First one is the bladder volume increases and the detrusor tone decreases. There is ureteric dilatation as a result of a combination of the progesterogenic relaxation of the ureteric smooth muscle and pressure from the expanding gravid uterus. There is increased urinary stasis, compromised ureteric valves, and vesicoureteric reflex, which all facilitate the bacterial colonization and ascending infection. Increase in urinary stasis results in dilatation of the ureters, which can ascend to the renal pelvis and calluses. And these are more commonly seen in the right side. It is 86% seen on the right side. And also, the degree is more on the right side. The dilatation can be up to 15 millimeters on the right side versus 5 millimeters on the left ureter. These changes begin as early as 10 weeks of pregnancy and these worsen throughout as the pregnancy advances. The other reason for UTI in pregnancy is sexual activity. Intercourse can traumatize the urothelial of the distal urethra, resulting in bacterial invasion. And also, it could be due to difficulty with hygiene because of the distended gravid abdomen as the pregnancy advances. The other reasons are maternal immunity, which is slightly reduced during pregnancy, and increasing age and lower socioeconomic status also have an impact in increased chances of getting UTI. The other causes which are not so common are concomitant urinary tract anomalies and maternal diseases like diabetes or sickle cell disease. And we should also keep in mind the medical interventions which are performed during pregnancy, that is the nosocomial infections like urethral instrumentation or catheterization, if not done in proper sterile conditions, can predispose to ascending bacteriuria. The other risk factors, which are rare, are neurogenic bladder retention, history of vesicoureteral reflux or history of previous UTIs, previous renal transplantation, multiple pregnancies due to the pressure effect, and prolonged hospitalization. Glycosuria in pregnancy is itself a risk factor. This is seen in 15% of healthy pregnant women due to increased GFR and due to a higher postprandial glucose levels. So glycosuria in combination with the physiological amino aciduria of pregnancy and a fall in urine osmolality favors the bacterial proliferation. The next medical condition, preeclampsia, also predisposes to UTI because the underlying renal damage which happens in preeclampsia weakens the patient's systemic defense mechanism against the ascending infection. In cases of mild preeclampsia, the chances of UTI is around 27.3%, and in severe preeclampsia, it's around 35.9% compared to 16% in normotensive pregnant women. Now, let us know what are the consequences of bacteriuria in pregnancy. The maternal consequences are there is an increased risk of preeclampsia, anemia, chorioamnionitis, preterm labor, and postpartum endometritis. The fetal consequences of bacteriuria in pregnancy are fetal growth restriction, low birth weight, prematurity, stillbirth if not treated, perinatal mortality, and infancy. It's postulated that direct bacterial endotoxin damage in combination with cerebral hyperperfusion is responsible for mental retardation and developmental delay. Now, let us move on to the symptoms of UTI. The commonly presented symptoms are pain, burning micturition, fever, frequent urge to urinate, lower backache, and fatigue. What adds to the trouble is the frequent recurrence of UTI. Burning micturition. This occurs because the urine becomes acidic, and infection in the urinary tract leads to inflammation. And this flow of urine irritates the urinary tract. Pain occurs because the infection triggers the release of chemicals which cause inflammation of the urinary tract. Now, what is recurrence of UTI? If UTI occurs minimum twice in 6 months or three times in a year, we term it as recurrence. And this usually happens because the E. coli tend to hide within the cells of the urinary tract, that is within the crypts of the epithelium. And it's difficult to flush out or kill such hidden E. coli. How do we investigate once we diagnose urinary tract infection? There are certain blood tests to know the kidney function like CBC, serum electrolytes, blood urea nitrogen, and serum creatinine. Next is the urine studies, and this is the most important one. We need to do a urine analysis and urine culture screening for all pregnant patients in their first antenatal visit and at 16 weeks. This helps us to identify the asymptomatic bacteriuria and glucosuria. Urine culture is sufficient for the reliable diagnosis of significant bacteriuria, provided there is a rigorous attention to sample collection, storage, and laboratory evaluation. We need to emphasize the fact that urine specimen collection with midstream CleanCat sample is very essential to prevent contamination. So we need to explain to the patient that with one hand she needs to spread the labia and with the other hand she need to disinfect the urethral meatus downwards towards the rectum void the initial portion of the bladder contents into the toilet and catch the middle portion of the bladder contents in a sterile collection container while keeping the labia spread with the first hand. Now, what are the things we see in urine cytology? A very useful adjunct in detecting upper urinary tract infections are clumping of WBCs and WBC casts. This will suggest to pyelonephritis. And if there are RBC casts, this indicates acute glomerulonephritis. Oval fat bodies and fatty casts suggest membranous glomerulonephritis. And any proteinuria will suggest renal involvement. If the patient has nephrotic syndrome, there is going to be high proteinuria, edema, hypercholesterolemia, and hypoalbuminemia. We need to differentiate it from preeclampsia. Dipstick testing for nitrites and leukocyte esterase is very important in evaluating asymptomatic bacteriuria. It has a sensitivity of 50 to 92% and a specificity of 86 to 97%. This is a useful test and it is inexpensive. Leukocyte esterase may be unreliable in patients who have a low level of pyuria, that is 5 to 20 WBCs per high power field. In addition of protein and blood increases the sensitivity and specificity of the test in evaluation of UTI. Urine culture is a standard method for evaluating UTI during pregnancy. This is indicated also in pregnant women who have recurrent UTI, pyelonephritis, and those who fail to respond to the initial treatment and history of recent instrumentation and anyone who's admitted to the hospital. How do we interpret these results? Positive culture is when two consecutive voided specimens with isolation of the same bacterial strain at a colony count of more than 1 lakh colony forming units per ml or higher, or a single catheterized sample yielding a colony count of at least 100 colony forming units per ml. And what is a contaminated sample? When the counts are lower than 1 lakh colony forming units per ml with two or more organisms. The culture results antibiotic sensitivities. The culture reports yielding significant growths of mixed organisms should prompt a search for underlying renal calculi. Now let us move on to the presentation and management of the various types of UTI in pregnancy. First is asymptomatic bacteriuria in pregnancy. So as we already mentioned, the diagnosis is by the presence of more than 1 lakh colony forming units per ml of one or more uropathogens in two consecutive midstream urine specimens or one catheterized urine specimen in the absence of symptoms attributable to a urinary tract infection. The incidence in pregnancy is around 2.5 to 11%. And this is very important. It's very important to screen all the pregnant patients at the first prenatal visit and also at the 16th week of gestation. Treatment of asymptomatic bacteriuria in pregnancy is very important because it reduces the risk of pyelonephritis in pregnancy and consequently the risks of preterm birth and low birth weight. The treatment schedules are directed by urine culture and sensitivity testing, and the appropriate antibiotics based on the culture reports are continued for at least 7 days. There are several studies which have tested shorter treatment courses and even single dose schedules. The rationale is to improve the patient compliance and reduce the side effects, but a Cochrane systematic review of short courses found insufficient evidence to confirm treatment efficacy. Careful follow-up is necessary to establish the urine sterility. Hence, it is advocated to repeat the midstream sample of urine for culture regularly, at least every trimester until delivery. Coming on to the use of antimicrobials in pregnancy. In pregnancy, there is an increase in glomerular filtration rate. So this results in increased elimination rate of the renally excreted medications. Also, increased maternal plasma volume reduces the serum drug concentration and also adversely affects the amount of therapeutic activity at target tissue. That is, the bioavailability is reduced. This specially affects the beta-lactam antibiotics, penicillins, and the cephalosporins. Polyuria and frequency reduce the urinary drug concentration and the therapeutic window within the urinary tract. Hence, it is necessary to administer increased dosages or prescribe hydrophilic drugs to ensure efficacy of treatment. We need to consider the profile of the causative organism and the antimicrobial resistance trends within the local antenatal population. And also, one must remember the potential maternal side effects, the drug interactions, and the possibility of teratogenicity when any medication is prescribed in the antenatal period, especially in the early pregnancy. Antibiotic treatment has to be initiated upon the diagnosis of asymptomatic bacteriuria in pregnancy. Any of the antibiotics to which the urine culture comes as sensitive can be used, except for the fluoroquinolones and aminoglycosides, as they are contraindicated in pregnancy. In the absence of urine culture and sensitivity tests, empiric choice of antibiotics should be based on the local susceptibility patterns of the uropathogens. The most commonly used antibiotics in pregnancy are nitrofurantoin. It is not used near term. And the other antibiotics are the amoxicillin, clavulanic acid, cefalexin, and cotrimazole. Again, these are not used in the first and third trimester. The selection should depend on the sensitivity results of the urine isolate. So oral antibiotics are the treatment of choice for asymptomatic bacteriuria and cystitis. As mentioned previously, single dose treatment which has been used are amoxicillin 3 grams, ampicillin 2 grams, cephalosporin 3 grams, nitrofurantoin 200 mg, or trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole 320 1600 mg, and phosphomycin 3 grams sachet at bedtime. According to the FDA pregnancy risk, the drugs which come under category B include the nitrofurantoin, amoxicillin and clavulanic acid, and cephalosporins. So these are safely administered in pregnancy. The category C drugs include the trimethoxazole and sulfamethoxazole. Aminoglycosides are in the category D, hence they are not administered in pregnancy. Moving on to the next type of UTI, that is acute cystitis in pregnancy. The most frequent symptom which suggests acute cystitis is dysuria. The other symptoms are frequency, urgency, and suprapubic pain in the absence of systemic illness. There could also be bacteriuria without fever and costovertebral angle tenderness. Sometimes gross hematuria may also be present. 30% of women with asymptomatic bacteriuria, if untreated, will develop acute cystitis during their pregnancy. In a pregnant woman who is suspected to have acute uncomplicated cystitis, we should obtain a urine culture and sensitivity test of a midstream catch urine sample. In the absence of urine culture, the laboratory diagnosis of acute cystitis can be determined by the presence of significant pyuria, which is defined as more than 8 pucels per millimeter cube of uncentrifuged urine, or more than 5 pucels per hyperbore field of centrifuged urine. And also a positive leukocyte esterase and nitrite test is conclusive of acute cystitis, that is severe bacteriuria in pregnancy. We also should keep in mind the differential diagnosis here of gonococcal and non-gonococcal urethritis. These acute urethral syndromes also present with dysuria, frequency, pyuria, and sometimes hematuria, but without significant bacteriuria upon culture. The only distinguishing clinical feature is the presence of urethral discharge. Non-gonococcal urethritis is caused by chlamydia, mycoplasma, and rarely gram-negative bacteria. Also, non-urethral and non-urinary tract infections and chemical cystitis should be excluded when the patient presents with acute cystitis in pregnancy. Sometimes the women can also have symptoms of acute cystitis, but she may have vulvitis, vaginitis, or cervicitis secondary to herpes simplex. Hence, it's essential that an accurate physical examination be performed to complement a detailed clinical history. Treatment of acute cystitis in pregnancy. We need to advise the patient to increase oral fluid intake to dilute the uropathogen concentration. And also, it is recommended to drink cranberry juice. Urine alkalizing agents are prescribed routinely, but we should be careful of hypernatremia when we use sodium citrate in pregnancy. Simple analgesics are used to reduce suprapubic discomfort and dysuria. We should ensure that they do not have teratogenic potential and they have minimum side effects, and we should not exceed the maximum dose of analgesics. Empirical antimicrobial treatment can be initiated before the culture results, but they have to be evaluated and adjusted according to the culture results once obtained. A 7 to 10 day course of appropriate antimicrobial is sufficient to eradicate the infection. There are concerns with shorter courses and single dose strategies because under treatment leads to persistent infection and progression to pyelonephritis. It is very important that the patient should be monitored at intervals regularly until delivery to confirm that the urine examination is sterile during pregnancy. If there is primary treatment failure or relapse, we need to treat with 7 day course of a different antimicrobial in accordance with the sensitivity testing. And we also should consider the possibility of an underlying pathology. Moving on to the third type, pyelonephritis. This is the most serious type of urinary infection in pregnancy, and this is responsible for most of the perinatal complications associated with the presence of bacteriuria. 90% of antepartum cases occur in the last two trimesters. It represents infection of the renal papilla, which if untreated can spread to multiple papillae and occasionally to the renal cortex. Pyelonephrosis occurs when there is infection of the whole kidney. If the capsule ruptures, a perinephric abscess can also develop. Gram-negative septicemia and septic shock leads to multiple organ failure and serious sequelae. Women with pyelonephritis have acute cystitis in the early stages, and lower urinary tract symptoms can initially predominate. What is the incidence of pyelonephritis? This is seen in 2% of all pregnancies, 2% during the first trimester, 30% during the second trimester, and 46% in the third trimester. It's therefore essential to evaluate all women for systemic symptoms such as pyrexia, rigor, nausea, vomiting, renal angle pain in order to establish an accurate diagnosis and initiate treatment. They also present with flank tenderness. In 50%, flank tenderness is seen on the right side, and in 25%, it is seen on the left side, and bilateral in the remaining 25%. Since there is systemic involvement in pyelonephritis, it's very important for us to look for fetal tachycardia. The fetus should be assessed as part of any clinical evaluation in case of pyelonephritis. The diagnostic gold standard in pyelonephritis is a renal biopsy, but this is not practical in antenatal practice. A combination of symptoms, complete blood count and inflammatory markers, renal function tests, blood and urine culture testing help us in management of pyelonephritis. Moving on to the treatment of pyelonephritis in pregnancy. Majority of women with clinical features of pyelonephritis require hospital admission. If the woman presents with minimum symptoms, outpatient treatment and oral antimicrobial treatment can be started. It is mandatory to do a full maternal clinical history and examination and assessment of the fetal well-being. We have to perform blood cultures for aerobic and anaerobic bacteria, take vaginal swabs, and do the midstream sample of the urine for culture before starting her on treatment. Analgesia is important for severe renal angle pain. Simple painkillers can be given, and only if there is a severe renal colic, opiates may be necessary. We should avoid non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs because they are associated with fetal risks of oligohydramnios and premature ductus arteriosus closure. And also the mother can have risk of gastric mucosal ulceration and reduced renal perfusion. since the patient will be admitted and on bed rest, thrombophylaxis plays an important role, especially because of reduced mobility. Graduated compression stockings and low molecular weight is advocated as thromboprophylaxis. If the woman tocolysis may be necessary, antenatal steroids for fetal lung maturity if there is an evidence of threatened preterm labor. Coming on to antimicrobial therapy for pyelonephritis. This is initiated empirically and it's usually parenterally given if the woman is having fever or nausea and vomiting. Initially, the treatment is started with a broad spectrum antibiotic and subsequently narrowed down depending on the culture results. The parenteral treatment should be continued until the woman is afebrile for a minimum of 24 hours. It's very important to re-evaluate treatment if the woman is not responding within 24 to 48 hours of antimicrobial treatment and once the culture and sensitivity results become available. The treatment for pyelonephritis should be continued for a minimum of 10 days as relapses can occur only after 7 days of treatment. Some advocate for longer, that is 14 to 21 days treatment. It's important to confirm urine sterility after treatment and reassess through the remainder of pregnancy. The most common reason for initial treatment failure and deterioration in pyelonephritis is uropathogen resistance to the antimicrobial treatment. This should be re-evaluated with the culture results and advice of the microbiologist should be sought and the antibiotic should be changed as appropriate. If there is treatment failure, even with the appropriate antimicrobials, we need to exclude underlying pathology or a renal tract anomaly. Renal calculi can also cause persistent infection. Radiological advice regarding the appropriate imaging modalities should be sought in such cases. Investigations and the resuscitation instituted when there is severe sepsis or septic shock is diagnosed should always involve an intensivist, a urologist, a nephrologist, and a microbiologist for assessing and admitting to the intensive care unit. A few words on recurrent infection. Urinary infection recurs in around 5% of pregnancies. The risk of developing pyelonephritis and its consequences are the same as for primary infection. Again, the etiology is uncertain, but reinfection by coliform bacteria from the vaginal reserve occurs as a result of sexual activity. Urinary tract anomalies must be excluded in cases of recurrent infections. Postpartum evaluation is advisable after several episodes of antenatal infection. Long-term, low-dose antimicrobial cover or a single post-coital. If the UTI is thought to be related to sexual intercourse, a post-coital or bedtime dose of nitrofurantoin, 50 milligrams may be appropriate. Also, ceflexin to 50 milligrams has been used in such cases. A few words on renal ultrasound and limited IVP. This is indicated when an anatomic abnormality or renal disease is suspected. Patients with suspected pyelonephritis who are not responsive to appropriate antibiotic therapy even after 48 to 72 hours of the appropriate antibiotic. And in recurrent UTI or symptoms suggestive of renal calculi, if the benefits of a definitive diagnosis outweigh the minor risk of radiation. The total dose of ionizing radiation should not exceed 3 to 5 centigrades during the course of pregnancy. And of particular concern is the radiation which is delivered during the first trimester, that is during the organogenesis. So this can safely be administered when the benefits outweigh the risk. So now there are a lot of combination medicines which are available to treat the symptoms of UTI for the pain, for the controlling the acidic pH of the urine, and also along with that we will be supplementing the antimicrobials. So use of existing fixed dose combinations they could contain either alkalizers or cranberry or mannose or a painkiller. So the patient may require multiple medications to treat their symptoms. So there are some products which have all of them together, which will improve the compliance of the patient. And one such thing is UTI flush. So this is in the form of a sachet, and this can be given once or twice to the patient, depending on whether it's an acute UTI or a recurrent UTI. So this has components like ursolic acid, which is a powerful anti-inflammatory and an analgesic agent. This inhibits the pro-inflammatory cytokines, tumor necrosis factor alpha, and prostaglandin E2. The anti-inflammatory effect is comparable to NSAIDs, and this provides rapid relief from pain. It is also a powerful antioxidant. This prevents the tissue damage and inflammatory response to reactive oxygen species. Potassium magnesium citrate in UTI flush produces high concentration of bicarbonate in the urine, thereby neutralizing the pH of acidic urine of the infected urinary tract. This alkalizer relieves the symptoms of burning micturition. The next important component is the proanthocyanidin A. This is an active ingredient of the cranberry extract. The cranberry extract contains three types of PACs, PAC A, B, and B2. PAC A is having anti-adherent property. This prevents the pili of the E. coli attaching to the uroepithelium. This helps in flushing the E. coli and thus prevents E. coli reservoir formation and recurrence. D. mannose is naturally present, and it's a defense mechanism in the urinary tract to prevent UTI. The nephrons secrete this glycoprotein, which has high content of D. mannose. This also has an anti-adherence property on E. coli. So this product could alone help in relieving the patient of pain and inflammation, burning micturition, and also could prevent recurrence. So this could provide a rapid relief from all these symptoms. So there are a lot of studies which are published, which emphasizes on the effects of cranberry extracts, as it reduces the inflammatory response and it controls the symptoms of UTI. Finally, a few words on the complications which can happen if UTI is not treated. Perinephric cellulitis and abscess and septic shock, these are rare complications. Renal dysfunction could be transient, but as many as 25% of pregnant women with pyelonephritis have decreased glomerular filtration rate. Hematological dysfunction is seen rarely. And pulmonary injury, this is seen in 2% of women with severe pulmonary pyelonephritis during pregnancy, because of systemic inflammatory response syndrome and respiratory insufficiency. Surgical treatment is rarely indicated unless one of the pathologic causes are urethral or bladder diverticulum, bladder stones, urethral syndrome, lower urinary tract trauma, interstitial cystitis, or bladder cancer, where cystoscopy may aid in establishing the diagnosis. A retrograde stent or a percutaneous nephrostomy should be placed to relieve the urethral colic or decompress an obstructed infecting collecting system. Invasive procedures are rarely indicated. So finally, what are the tips on do's and don'ts to prevent UTI in pregnancy, which can be suggested to our patients? The do's are, we need to emphasize our patients to wipe from front to back during maturation and practice good genital hygiene. They should try to fully empty their bladder during urination. They should drink plenty of fluids, at least 8 glasses of water daily, and take showers instead of bath, to wear loose cotton innerwear and loose fitting pants, to urinate as soon as possible after intercourse, avoid douching and drink cranberry juice, and have fruits which are rich in vitamin C and antioxidants. They should not be using soaps, perfumes, or talcum powder in the genital area. They shouldn't hold urine if they feel the urge to pass urine. They shouldn't wear tight synthetic innerwears such as nylon and they shouldn't be wearing tight jeans or trousers. Finally, the take-home message. A urinary tract infection happens when any part of the urinary system, that is the kidneys, the ureters, bladder, and urethra, become infected by bacteria. UTIs in pregnancy are more likely to cause complications. They don't always have symptoms, known as asymptomatic bacteriuria, but in pregnancy, even those without symptoms need to be treated. Developing a UTI during pregnancy is common because of the numerous changes happening in pregnancy. These changes can allow the bacteria to thrive in the urinary tract, the bacteria proliferate and spread the infection. Urinary tract infections during pregnancy is associated with significant maternal and perinatal morbidity and mortality. Hence, it's very important for us to diagnose them and treat them appropriately. All patients should have a urine culture test done early in pregnancy at their first visit and checked for the signs of UTI, even if they have no symptoms. Treatment should be guided by urine culture and sensitivity reports. Selection of an antibiotic safe to use during different stages of pregnancy is important. If the infection reaches the kidney, it can cause inflammation or pulmonary complications. And if untreated, UTI in pregnancy can increase the risk of complications such as pyelonephritis, low birth weight baby, and premature birth. So with this, I would like to conclude my talk. Thank you. If there are any questions, I would like to take them.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for giving this informative speech on UTI in pregnancy. So let me see whether we have any queries on this topic. So ma'am, one question is there. Is there any difference in the treatment protocol in first and third trimester in pregnancy with UTI?
There is no difference in the treatment. See, in the compared to the antimicrobials, depending on what is the sensitivity pattern in the urine culture, we will be treating it depending on the FDA category. If the like we have the nitrofurantoin, which is a category B drug, it is safe in all in the first trimester of pregnancy. So we give nitrofurantoin or amoxicillin clavulanic acid. Usually, they are category B drugs and safe. In third trimester, if the patient has a high risk, I mean, if she is in threatened preterm, so she may require other medications. Like tocolysis, or she may require steroids for fetal lung maturity in case she's in threatened preterm. Otherwise, per se, only for the urinary infection, the treatment will depend only on the urine culture report.
And one more question, that do you think there is any kind of side effect taking the cranberry juice during UTI?
I would recommend to have the cranberry fruits if possible, because they are rich in fiber, because most of the juices will have a high sugar content. Any fruit, you know, any fruit which is rich in vitamin C, like orange colored fruits, orange, musambi, yes, or lemon, pineapple, all these things, you know, it's always better to take fruits because that will have high fiber content and high vitamin C. And cranberry, if it's possible to take the fruits, it's good. Taking the juice as such is not having, I mean, it's not been shown to have any side effects.
And would you recommend?
So it can be taken.
Okay. And would you recommend a UTI flush during antibiotic treatment with this scenarios? UTI in pregnancy?
Yeah, because the associated symptoms, you know, see, the patient comes to us with all these symptoms and this will give her the symptomatic relief. Okay, the pain, the burning micturition, because these all happen because of the bacteria. We need to treat the root cause also. So antimicrobials are definitely required. So along with that, for the symptomatic relief, the other medications like analgesics, alkalinizers are very much important. They will provide symptomatic relief from UTI. And antimicrobials will treat the, it will kill the bacterial agents. And after the complete course is done, we will do another urine culture to see if it is a sterile sample. So by that, we will know that the infection is completely cured.
Okay. Then one more question is from Dr. Deepa. Why nitrofurantoin should be avoided near term?
This is shown to affect the fetus. So hence, we do not use it in the at term. And also in patients who have G6PD deficiency, in such cases, we do not use this drug.
Okay, ma'am. And thank you so much for giving this wonderful session with Shield Connect. And I also thanks all the participants to join with Shield Connect and have this very interactive section with Dr. Tara Devi. And I also thank to all our Shield team member to make this webinar possible. And we would like to have more sessions with you in future. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, madam.
Sanjay, I would like to thank everyone from Shield Connect for giving me this opportunity, and I would like to thank the audience for attending this session. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for the basket.
Thank you, madam.
Bye.
With your permission, I am ending the show, madam.
Sure. Thank you, sir.